Hello guys, I'm Harshvardhan Saman and today we are going to talk about ballastless track. It is also called as STS, that is slab track system. Giving you a brief introduction about myself, I am a civil engineer and currently pursuing my post-graduation in rail and metro technology. Today I am put for a small topic called slab track system, which is one of the small topic among the vast ocean of railway engineering. These are the topics which we are going to see today. We will be talking about historical background, what is slab track, then suitability of track design, then we will see what is transition, its requirements and techniques to deal with transition settlements. Then we will look into classification of slab tracks. In that, we are going to talk about two different systems, that is Rheda and Shinkansen. Then we will be talking about track stiffness in both ballasted and in slab track. We will be also seeing slab track system on bridges, elastic components and in that fastenings. We will be looking at track accessibility to road vehicles, how it is provided in tunnels. We'll have a short comparison between ballasted track and slab track, and then we'll move on to cost and economics of slab track. So talking about historical background, the first slab track was installed beginning of 20th century, but the extensive development as we see today was started only after 1970s. If I am not wrong, in 1972, Rheda and Shinkansen were installed for the first time. So what is a slab track? A slab track is a concrete or asphalt surface that is replacing a standard ballasted track. If we use concrete or asphalt, obviously we are going to get a stiff and less elastic structure. So we need some elasticity, which we obtain by inserting elastic components below rail or sleepers. There are two figures in front of you. One is ballasted to your left and the slab track to your right. You may easily notice the difference between two. The figure to my left consists of black color stone gravels, which in railway terms we call as ballast. So as the track having ballast is called as ballasted track. While to the right, we have concrete slab on every bonded layer. On that, we have concrete bearing layer and finally, we have sleepers embedded in concrete slab. So, as it consists of concrete slab, we say it's slab track or ballastless track. Suitability of track designs. Whenever we talk about any civil engineering structure, first thing which comes to our mind is soil. The first thing which we do is soil exploration. Each system has its own flexural stiffness. So depending on the bearing capacity of soil, decide the suitability of each system in our project. If we have soft soil, then we should use a system which has high flexural stiffness. Then only it will act as a bridge across the weak spots. Transition requirements. So, transition points occur in a substructure between embankment, bridges and tunnels. There are also superstructure transition between slab tracks and ballasted tracks. So, what do you mean by transition? In the figure in front of you, to your left is a ballastless track and to your right is a ballasted track. So, when a train moves from ballasted track to ballastless track, it moves from ballast to concrete slab. So each material will have different stiffness and different properties. So this zone in between the two is called as a transition zone. So you will require some special care to deal with such transition zones. So speaking to definition of transition, transition points are the areas where the rigidity of the track shifts due to different elastic properties between the dissimilar track structures. The transition affects smoothness, safety of the ride and damages the superstructure of the track. This is a typical figure showing differential settlements, especially over an approach. This is a transition zone. Now, techniques to deal with a transition settlement. So equalized stiffness by gradually decreasing the elasticity of the rail fastening. Then install two extra rails over a length of 20 meters. So in the flow, you can see almost 1/4 is there on slab track and 3/4 rail is there on the ballasted track here. So these two extra rails are provided to negotiate the transition point. Here we have slab track and here we have ballasted track. So this is a transition point. We will use chemical binders, or we can use geopiers such as stone columns or concrete piles or timber columns. Now we will come to classification of slab track system. Broadly, it is classified into two systems, that is discrete rail supports and continuous rail supports. And the major makes are nothing but the or patented methodologies of various companies. So by going with the first, we will speak about sleepers or blocks embedded in concrete. Sleepers are cast into concrete through or directly on top of the concrete bed. It follows top-down track alignment. Reduction of vibrations as the complete elastic isolation of the supporting blocks from the concrete slab is done. It is easy to exchange of varying parts, that is rails, fasteners, etc. Then we have sleepers on top of asphalt or concrete bed. Here sleepers are bound directly on the top of an asphalt or concrete layer. Bottom up track alignment is method is adopted. High quality bottom layer is required because we are going to place sleepers on top of this bed. Then easy exchange of sleepers and other varying parts is also possible. Third method, prefabricated concrete slab. This is an entire concrete slab. It is reinforced or pre-stressed precast concrete slab. It follows top-to-down track alignment method, and higher quality is achieved due to industrial manufacturing process. Easy exchange of wearing parts is possible. High level of mechanization is achieved. Use of prefabricated elements avoid handling of wet concrete on site, which obviously controls the quality and maintains the quality of the structure. Disadvantage is that it consumes considerable height and is little expensive. Moving on with the fourth method, we have monolithic in situ concrete slab. So here continuous monolithic concrete layer is cast and direct rail fastenings are adjusted on it. Here top to down track alignment method is adopted. Additional devices for adjustment of the mutual rail position, that is rail inclination and gauge, are always required. For that we use devices such as gauge bars to maintain the gauge. The disadvantage is that well experienced staff is required. Then we have continuous rail supports. In this, embedded rail structures and clamped and continuously supported rails. Not much difference is there between the two. Both are continuously elastically supported rails by the means of compound such as cork or polyurethane, which surrounds almost the entire rail profile except the rail head. You can see in the figure, this is the filler material which is shown in red, and only the rail head is visible. Rest all is embedded in the track. It follows top to down track alignment approach. It is difficult to install. As seen in the previous methods, additional instruments are also required in this method. The greatest advantage is that there is absence of dynamic forces due to secondary bending between single rail support. There is reduction in noise production as it is completely enclosed and increases the lifespan of the rails and further reduces the maintenance with respect to discrete supports. It is best suited for moving road traffic over it. Disadvantage is that there is no turnout solution yet identified. Thus, we cannot use it for high speeds or for freight transport. So this is the overall classification of slab tracks. So talking about Rheda 2000. Rheda was first used in 1972 in Germany. on Rheda Wittenberg station that this was first installed. Thus, from the station name, this method has been named as Rheda. In 2000, there was a major design update, and thus this new update is called as Rheda 2000. The system structure consists of modified bi-block sleepers, which are embedded in monolithic concrete slab. Speaking out with the methodology, first substructure is prepared, in which we have embankment or cutting, on which the first layer, that is frost protection layer, is built up. Then we have placing of HBL layer, that is hydraulically bonded layer, using conventional construction machine. Then we have other civil structures built on it. After having a substructure, we'll move on to for assembly of track panels. In this, such twin bi-block sleepers are first laid, and over that rails are fixed with fastenings. This is a pre-assembled track. Then rough alignment of track panel is carried out. Actually, in any slab track techno system, track alignment is a crucial part, because this is fix and forget type of system. After concreting, we cannot do anything, as the life of this is up to 60 years. So for next 60 years, we cannot even change the alignment. A tolerance of 0.5 mm is achieved in aligning the track in gauge as well as in alignment. Then we'll do installation of formwork, because in between these sleepers we'll have to pour concrete. So formwork is done on the sides of the slab, and final alignment using machineries is done. Now here the tolerance of 0.5 mm, which I've told previously, is achieved. Then we do placing of concrete. It can be manual as well as automatic by the use of machines. Then supplementary work such as curing, etc., is done. We loosen up the fastening so that we avoid stresses in unset concrete. This is the cross-sectional view. Here this height will vary depending on the subgrade and the properties of underneath soil. Then here we have shown the layers of construction. From subsoil, we'll move on to frost protection layer, then HBL layer, then we'll place twin block sleepers, then we'll place rails, and we'll use temporary fastenings, then we'll do concreting, and then permanent fastening are laid. The gap between two tracks is filled up with asphalt or with concrete. This is how the complete view of track will look. Now moving on with our next system, that is Shinkansen slab track. This was also developed in 1972 in Japan. The overall procedure remains the same, but there are three noticeable differences between Rheda and this system. Cement is used for stabilizing of sublayer. Then we have cylindrical stoppers to prevent lateral and longitudinal movement. This is nothing but slab, and these are the cylindrical blocks which basically prevents linear movement of this slab. This reinforced pre-stressed slab with 4 cm thickness of bituminous mortar is injected between the slab. Each slab weighs around 5 tons, and special attention is required while injecting bituminous mortar, as it is the most crucial bonding layer. If something goes wrong injecting and in filling this gap, then the entire system is a failure. This is how the track looks after finishing. These are the individual slabs. So moving next, that is track stiffness in ballasted track system. In this, the ballast bed provides half the resilience needed to absorb the dynamic forces, and other half is provided by the subgrade. So basically the ballast and the subgrade, they provide resilience to the ballasted track. Rail pads are also used between rails and sleepers to filter out the high frequency vibrations. But when we talk about slab track system, we don't have ballast. So elastic rail pads and under sleepers replace the ballast in terms of load distribution and damping function. Therefore, these elastic rail pads are the most important, as it is the only component in the track with elastic and dampening properties. Now, slab track system on bridge. Mostly we have seen metro viaducts or elevated structures. They are all slab tracks on bridges. bridges provide rigid foundation to the slab tracks. We don't have to provide an extra concrete slab. This is provided by the deck top surface. However, the temperature changes and traffic loads cause bending, longitudinal movements and twist of the bridge structures over the supports. The bridge superstructure should be designed to cater the stresses and deformation. So solutions adopted on bridges are by reducing the clamping force in fasteners. The moment of bridge structures are eliminated if the sleepers are rigidly connected to the bridge. Track frame concrete or concrete asphalt subbase is provided on between the track and the deck so that the track moves freely. Or by providing rubber bearing below the precast slab. Here you can see rubber bearings which were provided. Now, slab track system on steel bridges. The application of STS on steel bridges is less frequent and it is still under research stage. So, it is not advisable to provide it on steel bridges. Now, moving to our further topic, that is elastic components of slab track system. Rail pads. It is provided between railways and sleepers. They improve load distribution and provides great passenger comfort. There is less wear on superstructures. Base plate, it is provided between grooved base plate and concrete slab. It reduces vibration due to wheels and track irregularities. Intersection plates of sleepers, it is used to reduce airborne sound. Sleeper pads, these are installed in factories itself and it performs well in switches, crossing or transition areas. Continuous rail supports provides an homogeneous stiffness. It is able to compensate installation related height differences by a few mm. It is common solution for clamped rails where we have seen in the last two methods continuously supported rails, these rail supports are used. In embedded rails, it envelops the rail completely. So it provides as a joint sealing for water, prevents water from infiltration, as well as it also provides as sound insulation. Now coming to fastening system, Waslow 300 system is preferably used over all the systems. It includes high elastic rail pads which substitutes the elasticity of ballasted bed like this one. To allow the vertical movements of rail, the system provides special tensioning clamps. Additional stiffness can also be provided by using additional seal plates or a high elastic base. This is how it looks like. These are the components. It is screw, it is spring loaded. Then we have tension clamps. This is concrete sleeper. We have elastic base plate. We have this rail pad. Base plate grip. Track accessibility to road vehicles in tunnels. This is required because the space in tunnels is very less. We have to carry out maintenance intervention or during fire accident, we are in need of quick evacuation of passengers, a free passage of rescue vehicles, and ease of controlling and subduing of fire. Due to space constraints or inaccessibility in tunnels, there should be a facility of moving road vehicle inside the rail tunnels. So obviously we'll have railroad vehicles during accidents, but if we manage to get help of this normal vehicles which move on the road, then it will simplify the rescue and maintenance operations. Comparison between ballasted track system and slab track system. We'll first talk about the advantages of both the systems. In ballasted system, we have less construction cost or initial investment is less. Then we have accurate correction and mechanized maintenance, good drainage of water due to ballast, and low repair and maintenance cost. Here the maintenance requirement is only less. The reduction in structural height and weight, as we have discussed earlier, we'll be seeing in the next slide also how this height and weight is reduced. Then we have high lateral stiffness, increase in service life because wear and tear is less. Speaking on with the disadvantages, we have uneven settlements, lateral stability of track, and track operation and maintenance is time consuming. We require frequent blocks and the time of blocks is also too long. Here the derailments can cause huge damage. The repair works is more complicated and costly. You know, if there is any minute repair in the slab, the entire length of the slab should be replaced. And replace means it is all concreted. So we have to first break the concrete and then we have to remove the concrete and then we have to place fresh concrete. And doing this for a small section proves to be costly affair. And investment cost is also high. Speaking of with the advantages in tunnels and bridges, the application of slab track in tunnels and bridge is very efficient in terms of construction, durability, strength and economy. We have discussed earlier that maintenance requirement is very less. Places such as bridges or tunnels where there is space constraint, machinery required for maintenance in ballasted track is totally eliminated. On these rigid structures, the hydraulically bound layer HBL, what we have seen in the previous images, is not required, and there is reduction in the overall height of the track. So you can see here, this much diameter is reduced. Cost of slab track. Studies have proven that slab track is profitable only if the construction process does not exceed 30% than the cost of ballasted track. That means if slab track exceeds 30% and the cost of ballasted track, then the overall project is not profitable. Although the recent study suggests that the price of slab track decreases with the increase in construction line, the price factor still remains 1.5 to 2 times more than the cost of ballasted track. Means it always will exceed 30%. 1.5 means it is exceeding 50% and 2 means it is going up to 100%. This is the initial investment of ballasted track, and if slab track costs 30%, then the overall project is economical. But if this exceeds by 30%, then there will be some rise here also and the slab track will not that much economical. The benefits of slab track won't be too much. Instead of that, we could have gone for ballasted track where we could have saved the initial investment. The fruits of slab track will be benefited only after 40 to 50 years. Till then, almost you can see there is negligible benefit between the two systems. That only after 40 years, we can see a significant benefit of using a slab track. But all said and done, if it doesn't exceed 30%. Only clear case where slab track is economical is in case of tunnels, because there is no need of extra treatment at substructure. In embankments and in open areas, ballasted track is most economical and efficient choice. So thank you for your time, and if you have any queries, mail me at harshodansamant@outlook.com. You can also comment in the comment box below.